Like the title of my talks says distributed systems from scratch. If I stop there, anyone says, okay, that's fine, then put up part two. Now, a little bit background, what we are talking here is, if you looked at our agenda, or we say, what is our differentiator, one of the differentiator we talked about, for people who are continuously attending our meetups. That was one of the differentiator. And one of the challenge we have taken up this time is, can we do a session which goes across multiple meetups? Right, normally we do a session, we keep it for that meetup, we are done. But here what we are trying to do is that, take an idea and do a part one, part two, part three, till it runs. And can we do that? The reason is that some ideas or some sessions are very difficult to capture even in the longest meetup I know. Right, no one does for 4 hours or 5 hours. Mostly people are fine with 2 hours of meetups, but we run the most longest I know. But even that, some can be captured in that. So that one way, what we did is, we kept this thing and say part one we'll capture in one meetup. Then we did another thing. We will not do even continuously. We did a part one 3 months, like 3 months back. Now we are doing part two after 3 months. The reason is that sometimes after part one, people need time to digest it. Right, so then we'll come back to part two. Now let me, so that is kind of an idea of part one and part two series. I'm not sure how many people enjoy it or not, but I enjoy talking about it, so that's how it came in. But the question is what we are talking about, why it is taking part one and part two. One of the things people know that in our meetup, we cover Spark. We talk about API, we talk about runtime, we talk about a lot of these pieces, but one thing we normally don't talk about is the reverse way. The reverse way is that if I want to build something from my own, from scratch, how it's going to look like. Because now what we do is that we look at an API and explain you how that API is built. But no one kind of captures how to come up with that API. Right, so this kind of session idea was, if I am a person who can come up with a Spark, what is going to be my kind of approach to come up with the APIs? So that's why the name of the session is kept as distributed system from scratch, where we take a bottom-up approach, where we say we don't have nothing, now we want to create a distributed system which looks like Spark. Now you say, that's great, but who wants to use this? Right? You talked about all the memory management, all those things. Maybe there are people who say, okay, this is useful to us. Even when I was putting together this talks, I thought like this. This is only for our own understanding. I enjoy doing this. Maybe there are people who enjoy listening to it, and we are end of the story. But there is always twist in the story. What happened is that a week back, someone connected with me and say, I like your sessions on building distributed system on scratch, and we are using those in our some of the libraries. I say, why? What are you trying to do? What they are trying to do is, they are trying to port some of the Python libraries on top of YARN and HDFS. So which means they are writing a distributed system from scratch to run on YARN and HDFS. And I asked them, why you don't use Spark? Because Sparks do not fit into our library way of doing stuff. We don't want to use all the RDD data frame. We have a little bit different way of distributing pieces. Now what we want to do is that we want to build a library which will talk to YARN, which will talk to Mesos or all these things which Spark underneath talks to, but we want to build that from the scratch. Then I figured, oh man, there are some people who really want to do that. Right, so which means over a time what is going to happen is that people are happy with their systems which are built on top of this YARN, Mesos and HDFS, but there will be companies who will say, okay, this is great, but we have something custom in our in-house. We want to build that, and there is a very small amount of resources to do that. If you go out and in the web, if you see, are there resources? There are very few resources which talks about how to program against APIs like YARN, Mesos, and those kind of things. So that's where the idea came, where you say we take the Spark as a code base, and we try to learn how internally it's using these underneath systems in order to do real distribution and those kind of things. So that was the idea, and since we see a real user out there, that kind of encourages to go more and do a part two. Right, so in the part two, I am very specifically talking about one piece, is that you may say, okay, for a person who has not seen the part one, what is there for me? Right, that's what I was thinking is that, how many of you know we can add third-party jars in Spark? Right, we can say minus minus jars, okay? Now the question is, do you know how it works? Right, so we are going to talk about how a third-party jar library kind of looks like if you do it from the scratch, Of course, the idea comes from the Spark itself. So which means, even if you've not seen the part one, or even if you say, I don't care about how to do a distributed system from scratch, this kind of explains some piece of the Spark runtime, where you say, when I want to say third-party library, how it shifts the library across the things, and how it uses the internal Mesos or Yarn APIs in order to achieve that. So that is kind of a place where we are trying to do. Let us move on and see the agenda. Okay, so if you don't know me, who am I? My name is Madhukar Patak. I run a company called Data Mantra. You may have heard this a few times now. And where I consult and train on Hadoop, Spark, and maybe Flink in future. And if you want to connect with me, you can go to this website. Okay, so let us go ahead. Now the thing is that, what was the original idea? People who have not seen the part one, the original idea is what it takes to build a distributed system which looks like Spark. So very simple definition of problem, where you say, if someone can create Spark, what it can takes. Okay, next. Now the thing is that, why you want to do these kind of things? One of the reason motivation behind this idea was, some point of time, the creator of Spark gave a speech saying that the first version of Spark only had 1600 lines of code, which already had all the RDD and distributed system. Which means, that's great, which means if you can write those 1600 lines of code, you can really create a distributed system which is powerful as the 0.1 version of Spark, which is not too difficult to do. That's what I thought initially. Right, so that's why I say, okay, I can write those 1600 lines. Third thing is that I wanted to capture how I go about it. It's not just what is the end product, because you know the end product is Spark. I wanted to capture what it takes from saying zero to go on step by step. So I captured them in the blog some point of time. Now I'm trying to capture them in the talk so that people who are interested can go through the journey with me. The last point is important. I left the company 1.5 years back to do consulting. And one of the truth of the consulting is that you don't get job immediately. Right, which means you have a lot of time sitting and saying what I should do. So then I say, okay, let's write a system from scratch. Right, so that's why these days I'm not doing this, because there's a real moneymaker projects out there. But that point of time, I thought, okay, let's do that. So that's also important piece. Now, why it is possible? The question is that, why it is possible to create 1600 lines of code to create a distributed system? The reason is that we are leveraging a lot of frameworks which are already built for us. So if you see a distributed system from very high level, how it looks like? You have a distributed storage coming from HDFS. You don't have to implement it. HDFS is out there. If you want to do a distributed storage, you can just use it. If you want to do distributed cluster management, you don't have to write it. It's not like Hadoop, where you have to come up with job trackers, task tracker, those kind of things. You don't have to write it. What do you have to write it? You just use Yarn or Mesos. Now, what you only have to write is distributed processing system. Right? Only you have to kind of focus on how to come up with an API which talks to Yarn and HDFS and does some processing. And this piece do not take much work, at least to get the first API right. Of course, once you get into all this tungsten, custom memory management, you will go crazy. But unless, at least to understand what we do about it, is very easy to go over. So the reason why we can do it is, these two pieces, we take it for granted. Which means I don't really do distributed system per se. The distribution is done by Mesos or Yarn. I don't do really data processing distributed way, because HDFS does that. What I'm going to do is that I'm leveraging those two pieces in order to do that. That's what Spark did, and that's what I'm trying to go about. All are able to follow what we are trying to do. And Spark also has data applications where you build all these higher level APIs, which I'm not concentrating on. No, I know that no one is going to write code against my framework in production. If they are doing, just give me a call. I said it's the wrong idea. Now, to simplify this more, what I did was, a lot of people understand how to do data processing. Right, HDFS, everyone knows it. But one of the things people don't realize it is, distributed systems are not limited for data. There are use cases which goes beyond the data. So what I wanted to do was, I wanted to explore that idea where I say, if I don't want to do data processing, what else I can do? So what I did was, in my code, I got rid of HDFS. I don't do distributed data storage, or I don't talk to HDFS at all. I just only talk to Yarn or Mesos, because I'm not concentrating on an API which does data processing. Because a lot of other frameworks did it, a lot of people really understand what is this partitions, how to do MapReduce, etc., etc. I only concentrate on YAML Mesos or distributed processing system. All are able to follow how we are kind of going about it. Like what we are trying to say is that, can we come up with an API which looks like a Spark and tries to run on Mesos or YAML in order to do a distributed system? Fine. I see people faces a little bit confused, that's fine. All right, if you go to next slide. This is what it looks like. Mesos, how many of you heard Mesos? Okay, maybe. Think like it is a better version of YAML. Very simple. Now, here is where the difference is. Now, if you look at Spark, what is the abstraction layer you have? RDD. But my abstraction layer is not RDD. My abstraction layer is Scala function. It's much simpler abstraction, and the idea comes from Spark itself. I'll talk more about it. The abstraction layer is Scala function, which means you can take any Scala function and run it on a distributed mode. Think like the API says, you can give a Scala function, you can run it in the distributed mode. There is no data. Yeah.
In Java, yeah.
No, we have not done in Java. Yeah. So maybe with the Java 8 we can do it because they didn't have functions earlier. All are able to follow. So the abstraction layer is Scala function. And whatever you can write in the Scala function express logic, you can do it in a distributed way. So that's kind of an idea. So the API layer is just give a function, we convert it to a task, and we distribute it on the distributed systems. Make sense till here? All are able to follow? Now, where this idea comes from? Now, if you look at initial version of Spark, the abstraction for processing is from the Scala functions. Now what I mean by here, if you look at RDD, it's an abstraction for data, right? It's a collection of data. But when I want to process, I want to give a function. Now that function is normally a Scala function. What I mean, if I say RDD.map, what I'm giving a Scala function where I say run this function which accesses the data from the RDD. All are able to follow? So in the initial version of Spark, the task, what we say in the Spark, was a Scala function running in a JVM. So that was the original idea. And normally in the Scala, we represent the thing is like this. It is a function which takes something or not. It's an optional type and returns a type T, whatever the T. Maybe if you are doing map, it's a map of T. Then if you are doing a collect, maybe it's an array of something. But if you kind of distill everything out, like you remove map, flat map, reduce by key, and look at very high level, the distributed way of doing processing in Spark is a Scala function, and that's the reason we say Scala uses functional programming. Sorry, Spark uses functional programming. The reason is that the abstraction layer for doing distribution was Scala functions. And why they can do it? In Scala, a function is an object. And if it's an object, you can serialize and ship over the network in order to the distribution. That was the kind of original idea. And this Scala function can be parallelized and sent over network. That's the what it does. You can take a map function, serialize it, and send over the network. And the function is represented as a task, which means when you say there are 10 tasks running in the Spark, you mean there is a 10 instance of that function running in the 10 different machines. All are able to follow what is the kind of abstraction layer? Abstraction layer is Scala collection, sorry, Scala function, which we are using. Of course, over a time, what is a task? It got complicated because they added more and more features like accumulator, etc., etc. But initially, a task means a Scala function running in a JVM. All are able to follow till here. I want to show you some of the thing. I'm not sure. Did I open IntelliJ somewhere? Okay, just go and open IntelliJ. Go to one. Okay, just open distributed system from scratch. Yeah. I want to show you how that function looks like. Give it a second to load. And I may need a charger. Okay. Alright, so just go to the presentation mode. So if you say this, my task of T extends serializable, which means I'm creating a task which is task is anything which runs on a JVM. And I have a special task called as function task. What is a function task? The what I want to run, because there's a method called run, which means what to be run when you run a task, is a body of the function. Now you see, this may be a little bit new to you if you've not done a little bit advanced Spark, sorry, Scala. This means that take a body of a function which is lazy. Because when you take a body of a function as a parameter, you don't want to run it. So the notation is, we say body dot colon, and this notation, and it says it's a function which don't take anything, this answer t, which extends task of t. So here what I'm trying to say is that I have a task abstraction which has a run method, which means what to run when the task starts. I have a function task where I take the body of the function and says whatever you want to run this function, just do it. Now if you look at this abstraction, nowhere I'm writing data. Am I saying I'm going to take data? No, because I am not concentrated on RDDBs. I'm not concentrated on the function has to access to have a RDD and those kind of things. I'm just saying whatever you write in a function, you have ability to run it on a machine. And how we do it? Take the function, convert into a task which is can be serializable and ship it over the network. All are about to follow. What is the abstraction layer? Abstraction layer is two lines. There's a task, there's a function task. Okay, now let's go back to the slides. Okay, next. Now we talked about this, let us move on. Now you say, okay, this looks great, but if you see a TV shows, how many of you see TV shows? Or even in India we say serials, right? So both qualify. Normally what happens is that when you start with a TV show, they say, till now, what happened in the earlier sessions? Right, till now what is going on, so that you catch up a glimpse of, okay, I understand who was the hero, who was the heroine, or who was in trouble and who is going to be enjoying this piece. So people who are continuously thinking, they don't need it. This is for people who have not seen the shows for some time. Right, so till now what we have done, if you looked at our architecture, we had a mesos underneath. And a lot of people who have come to our sessions, normally they come from the YAN background. So in the part one, we have discussed extensively about mesos. What is mesos and what's the abstraction, etc., etc. The second thing is that, of course, as a mandatory, we've done the hello world on mesos, how to run a mesos. And also, we implemented how to run a Scala function on top of mesos. So whatever the abstraction we have discussed there, in the part one, we discussed how to take this function and run across the multiple machines using the mesos. Now you're saying, okay, that's drag because I wanted to do that. Don't worry, we have a, this is a, I think first time in our meetup slide, we are putting a YouTube link, which says, go and watch that video if you are interested. Right, so which means, if you are interested, you can catch up till now using this video, what saying, what is a mesos and why we use a mesos rather than YARN, and how what we have done with the Scala function API. All we are able to follow till now, what we are trying to do is that building the distributed Scala function on top of mesos. That's our distributed system. Now, from here on, what we want to do, the part two piece. Till now is like, in our TV show, that was what we wanted to talk about, and we already talked about what happened in the earlier episodes. What is this we are talking about? One thing is that, if you think about a Scala function, when it runs on any machine, what it can do or what it cannot do. Right? Those are the two pieces we are going to discuss. The first thing is that it has access to the local data. All agree? If I'm running on a machine, whatever the data is present in that machine, I have access to it. Now, if you think about RDD data also, normally that's how Spark works. If I run a function for an RDD, it tries to access the data from that local machine, which is there in the HDFS. All agree, that's what we call as a data locality piece. Right, then second thing is that it has the ability to access classes provided by the framework, which means if I'm running on the Spark, all the classes which are included in the Spark, I can load and use it. All agree? Okay, the third thing is that it can have any logic which can be serialized. So in Spark, what you can write in math, you can write anything in the math which can be serialized. If you are trying to use an object which cannot be serialized, then you get an error. For example, if you are trying to use Spark context inside a map, normally you get an error because it cannot be serialized. So if you take a function and say what it can do, it can access to the local data, it can actually get all the classes which are in your class path, The third thing is that it can do anything which can be serialized. All able to follow till here? Okay. The next thing is that what it cannot do by default. The first thing is that it cannot access classes which are third party. All agree? So if you are using Spark and if you are trying to do something which is not in the Spark, normally you get class not found exceptions. Because that local function only has access to the class path which is given by the framework. The second thing is that it do not have access to the output of other tasks. Because normally they are not stored in HDFS, they are normally stored in the local system or maybe in the local memory also. Which means if your function needs to access output of any other function, you cannot do it. Normally in Spark, we call it as a shuffle. Whatever the data which was generated by earlier task, if you want to access, a local function cannot do it because it only has access to the local data. And the final thing is that it cannot access broadcast data. What is the broadcast data? It's like a lookup data. Maybe from the main program I told, this is the data which you can access, but it's not local to it. Someone has to send the data to that thing. So which means these are the problems what we have in our existing distributed system, because as a local function, these three things I can do, but if I want to have a better distributed system, these three things cannot be done. All are able to follow what is the problem we are trying to solve. Now what we are going to do in our session is, we are going to look at the first point. How to access to the third party libraries using our framework and how we do it. And it's very similar how Spark does it. When the Spark started, these three things were straightforward because it's easy to do. After that, they started to add the first thing like how to have a third party library, then they started to add shuffle, then they added a few more. All able to follow till here? Now you can say what happens to the next second and third? They'll be covered in part three. Right, so that's where the part three comes. Okay, let's move on. Now, one of the questions is that why we need third party libraries? And why it is difficult to do in a distributed setup? Now, if I want to do third party library in the normal setup, it's very easy. Put to class path, everything is done. But in the distributed system, wherever the executor runs, you need to add that into the class path, right? So that's the hard part, which means if I want to use a third-party library, it is not straightforward in a distributed setup. The first thing is that why we need a third-party library? First one is connect to third-party sources. For example, if you have used a data source API, if you want to connect to something which is not built in, let us say MongoDB, you need to give the jar. All agree? That's like connecting to third-party sources. Second thing is, library to implement custom logic. For example, if you are doing matrix manipulation, you don't want to write everything in Spark. There is a library which is already doing that. What you do? You want to use that jar. Which means not only to connect to the third party sources, I want to also use some third party logic. Third thing is that ability to optimize for specific hardware. Is that, for example, what happens is that we can choose in this Spark, let us say, I want to say, let take my jar first, then the platform specific ones. For example, I can give you the better SSL than what you already shipping. Maybe I can give you better JSON parsing than what you are already giving to me, which means I can say for my setup, my hardware setup, or maybe my OS setup, this library is much better than what is given in the framework, which means I can also choose libraries which are specific to my setup compared to the generic ones. And also extending the base framework, which means Spark itself will not do Spark SQL. But if you want to add the Spark SQL to your setup, base framework may not ship them because that's too much to ship. Now we can say, take this jar and distribute to the other system. All are able to follow why we need a third-party libraries. Normally we think third-party libraries for processing, but normally it's much more than that. We want to connect to third-party sources. We want to do some more things which we want to do here. Now, there are different ways to do this. How many of you, okay, so let me do like a survey of ages. How many of you done Hadoop, like, 2-3 years back, MapReduce. All right, how many of you remember we used to create a Uber jar to distribute third-party libraries? Right, before the distributed, cache came along to add the jars, we used to just crank all our jars into one bigger Uber jar and give it to it. Now, I think some people still do it. Right, how many of you do Uber jar in Spark these days? Okay, no one is ready to admit, okay, only few. Yeah. Yeah, in the streaming, it used to be earlier Uber jar. Now, thing is, why people love Uber jar? Because it's easy to create. In the Maven, there is a shared plugin. In SPT, there is a another plugin. Just put a plugin, boom, you have a job. But there is a problem. The problem is that we, I know, one of our project, our jar is around 400 MB. So if I want to redeploy my jar, I'm working on the AWS cluster, I'm uploading 400 MB every time when I make a one piece of code of change. It's impossible to track. The second thing is that when you create a Uber jar, the dependency hell will broke loose. You get so many classes, you don't know where they are coming from, because you just went to web page and say, oh, these are the three lines to add a library. Great, let's add a library. But it's bringing like 1,000 libraries with that, which is not transparent to you. When you try to merge all the classes, now say, I have two classes, what you want to do with it? Say, I not ask for those classes, but just choose randomly. Maybe first class is fine, and it starts getting this error, like, this method is not found now. Right, that's the problem with the Uber jars. So, and another issue we have with the Uber jars is versioning. Let us say, you want to keep on improving your code, application code, and say, I want to try different dependencies at the same time. You can't do it with the Uber jar. If you have two dependencies, you will get killed. But with the other way around, I can add that jar separately to the cluster. I run my application code and test, is it going to be okay before I make a big shift into that. So initially, the people liked Uber jar. You can still do Uber jar in our existing system because you ship the jar, everything is fine. But Uber jar is not the right way to do it because it don't give you a control over it. That's the first thing. And it becomes a nightmare to ship because there's a huge amount of space issues which you have to do every time you go over. So what is the other approach? The other approach is to have an application jar different than your library jars. So you have a library jars which are completely different. You ship them differently than your application jar so that you can keep on iterating over your application jar without changing your jars which are there in the libraries. Are you able to follow? This is what Spark does it. Now the question is how it does. And what is the code we are going to do it in the Mesos so that we change in order to support that functionality. So that's kind of a two things we want to discuss. First thing, what is the design, which is actually the design in the Spark, and how to implement that design inside our distributed systems. Okay, let's move on. Distributing the jars design is very, very simple if you think about it. Now, what they do is that, normally where we give the jars? In the driver. Right, when we submit a Spark submit, we say these are the jars you wanted to copy. What Spark does is, it runs a something called jar server, HTTP server in your driver. So if you see in your Spark, when it comes up, it says there's a jar server running in HTTP some port. So what is this server is? It's a HTTP server which is able to ship your jars over the network. This is a part of your driver as the part of your UI, right? This HTTP UI comes along. As part of that, there's another piece which runs as HTTP server to give you the jars into other places. And what we do is that when the Spark creates executor, it tells to the executor that this is where the server is running. Now it can, what it can do, it goes to the jar server and says, give me all the jars. And when the executor comes up, it can add all those jars into the class. All are able to follow what I'm trying to say? When the driver comes up, it's starting that jar server which can give you all the jars, and where it has a jars, it's coming from the local system. Wherever you're submitting the job, you have to have jars there. Then what it does is, then it goes to the executor and says, okay, this is the jars place, just copy from me. All are able to follow? This is the design, how Spark does it. We'll see how to implement it in our own program, but this is like straightforward way. Now, only thing we want to see here is that whenever the executors are created, scheduler passes the URI. One of the things you have to know, whenever you create a Spark context, you can have multiple in the same machine. Only limitation is that you cannot have multiple in the same JVM, but there is a possibility that I can have multiple in the same machine. Then what happens? The port in which it is listening to, it will keep on changing. I think this one you may have seen in the like a UI. Sometimes a 4040, but if you already have another Spark context running, it's a 4041, which means the driver has to tell to the executor that this is the URI where you have to connect. This is not standard port which always is done to. Then what happens is that even the driver tells the executor which are the jars you have to download. Because what happens is that when you have a lot of jars, you don't need to download for all the executors. You can tell to one executor, you need four jars, this is the place where you can download. All are able to follow, this is a dynamic. The driver comes along, it creates the jar server, it gives the URI, it takes the things, and everything is fine. Now you can say, this is very straightforward. What's the big deal about it? The big deal about it is making it run on all different runtimes like Yarn and Mesos is a little bit tricky. How you do it in Mesos is a little bit different than how you do it in the Yarn, and the architecture what we discussed earlier is kind of neutral of where you run. This you can run in a local system, this you can run on Yarn, this you can run on Mesos, which is not depend upon anything which is specific feature from Yarn or Mesos. This is not depend upon that. It's a layer which is above than that. If you look at the MapReduce shipping, it's a little bit different. They use a distributed cache, they use a HDFS to ship the jar. The problem is that if you don't have a HDFS, you can't use it. If you don't have a distributed cache provided by the MapReduce framework, you can't use it. But Spark says, we don't care, we have our own way of doing. One optimization they have done to this original architecture is, they got rid of the HTTP layer. They have something called TCP layer using netting. So they used to use Jetty, we will talk about that later. They have optimized that, that's what Spark IO optimization we talked in the first place. Which means earlier this is the way we used to do. Problem is that HTTP has a little bit overheads, which you don't have it in the TCP side. So they have layered their kind of saying we were going to go with the TCP rather than HTTP. Why I kept HTTP? Because it's easy to understand. If I start showing the TCP IP bytes, you may go crazy because we already seen too much of bytes earlier. Right, so let's move on. So how are you going to implement it? So it's a multiple level. The first layer is you have to have HTTP server. That's the first piece, right? Unless you have HTTP server, you can't do it. The second piece is that you have to change in the driver. In Mesos, we call driver as a scheduler. The naming convention in Spark, we said driver, that's a main method. It is called as a driver. In Mesos, we call it as a scheduler, which means I have to start it when the driver comes up. I have to change in the executor layer because I have to tell to the executor, if you have a jar, download and add it to the class path. The question is how you add it to a class path which is already running. That's what we're going to talk about. Finally, there has to be a task or a function which uses this functionality. So these are like multiple things. First thing, I want to have a HTTP server. Next two things, change in the driver and change in the executor. Finally, show me an example which uses this functionality. All are able to follow till here? Okay. Now, what we need is, we want an embedded HTTP server here because I want it to be a part of the driver. Now, if you talk about HTTP server, you have so many options. You can go with the Apache thing, you can go with the Tomcat, you can go with the so many other options out there, but I can't use it because this HTTP server do not run like a different process. I want to run it as a separate thread inside my code. So then the one of the options you can go with is using Jetty. How many of you heard Jetty? Okay, so many of you. So one of the thing about Jetty is, it's not only a HTTP server, that's a web server, it's also a J2EE application container also. We are not using any of J2EE, but if you are using an embedded system, if you have a J2EE also, it's great, because then you can use all your servlet, JSP, all these things which can embed it in your JVM. We are using the HTTP server piece of it. The reason why we choose Jetty for two reasons. One reason is that's what Spark was using. The second reason is that it's very lightweight. You can embed without much code and it can run with very, very less resources. So that's the reason. And one of the things about Jetty is it's a part of open source Eclipse Orgs. You can go to the Jetty, eclipse.org or Jetty. You will get that thing. If you go to Netty, again, the names are very, very similar. They come from JBoss. Now the difference between Jetty and Netty is, Jetty is a HTTP layer which don't expose your TCP layer. Netty has both access to TCP and HTTP. Why you care about TCP? Performance. If you want to say HTTP is too much higher layer to me, I want to go lower layer, you can't do it in Jetty, then you have to go to Netty. Again, we are going with Jetty as of now, maybe some point of time, distributed parts 15, we may talk about Netty. Okay, let us go to code. I want to show you the HTTP server.scala, how Jetty will look like. Just open it. Okay, just enter. This should be the one. Alright, just go up. Now, this is a HTTP server, and if you see what is the HTTP server takes, you know when you create any server, you need to give a resource base. How many of you have done PHP? No? Okay, few of you. So you know, in Apache, if you do PHP, you say var slash www. That's your resource space from where you read your files. Here what I'm saying, give me a path where all the jars are available to me. So that's the thing. Now if you come down, there's a star. Now what I do is that when you run a HTTP server, you have to give a thread pool. Why? Because a server can give multiple, it can handle multiple requests. You should be able to scale, that's why there's a thread pool. And how you create a server is, you say new server, this server is coming from the Jetty. And what is the zero? Any idea? What is the zero means?
Any available port.
Yeah, any available port. So if you say star normally, that means like any number of any kind of port. Here I'm saying zero, which means I don't care which port you start on, just start. And if you come down a little bit, okay, so there is a way to say resource handler, because what happens there is a if you done Tomcat, normally we use web.xml, which says given this path, this is a servlet you have to go to. If you do PHP or any of the non-J2EE, then there is a way to connect your source, that's a path, to the file location. The default handler says that whatever the location, just go and get me the file. I don't care about any other processing. There is no processing. It is like a static server which is giving you the static files. There is no intermediate piece here. And finally, how I get a port is that you look, ask the server, give me the port. Because I told you that it starts in any port, once I'm done all the setup, then I go to the server and say which port you have started, so that I can give it to this, the executors. Are you able to follow? What we are doing here is that we are using Jetty to embed the HTTP server inside our distributed system. Fine? Okay. You go to the slides. Okay, just have a file. Next. Now, one of the things is that once we are done with the HTTP server implementation, the question is how we started. Where we started at the driver level, right? So what we are going to do now is that we are going to look at the driver code and say how we are going to start it. Now, here you need to know a little bit of Mesos. I will cover what you need to know in this, because we have got that in part one. Let us go to the code, where you want to start. Just open the task scheduler. Yeah. If you go a little bit up, now task scheduler, if you go to right, I have to see what it extends from. Okay, it extends from something called scheduler. Think scheduler is like an entry point into Mesos. Right? Scheduler is kind of entry point. In the Spark, you can think it's a driver. So from where you enter into the overall distributed system. And if you come down, if you go left, it has this concept of callbacks. Which means whenever you do any processing, you get a callback. For example, what is a callback you get for error? It's a callback for if there's an error in your processing. So the driver has to know about the error so that you will tell it to the front user saying that there's an error. What is executor lost? Maybe you spawn multiple executors to run the process. One is lost, you get a callback. So one of the difference between YARN and Mesos is a callback based API. YARN is completely different beast, which is always uses Java kind of blocking APIs. There's a completely different thinking in terms of how you do the message passing. And if you come down a little bit, right. Now the question is that where are we going to run this jar server? Which is the callback we use in the Mesos to run this thing? Normally we want to do it when actually it comes up first time. Because there's a possibility that you run some method again and again for every request you want to submit to the cluster, but you don't want to run the jar server. So in a Spark subpage you can run any number of jobs, but the dependencies you can give only once. All agree? So the callback what we are going to use here is called as register. So if you go here and search for registers, this one is very difficult to say. Okay, in the registers, what I'm saying is that jar.size is greater than 0, create a jar server. Again, this is an optimization. If you don't have a jar, don't start a jar server, because what you are distributing here. So go to the create jar server, what we are trying to do, if you come down. Now one of the things we are doing here is that we are creating a temporary directory which act as a resource file. Which means I want to give a folder where all the jars are there. What I'll do, I'll create a temporary directory, and I copy all the jars whatever given by the user to that temporary directory, and I make that directory as a resource for my HTTP server. All are able to follow till here? Now if you take the same example and Spark, if you see the logs, you can say these jars are copied into slash tmp and spark piece, which means all the jars what you have specified, they are not directly read from all the actual places. They copy everything into one place, and from that place they actually ship those jars rather than actually going and finding in your folders. So what we are doing, all the jars what you have given in the command line spark submit, we are copying those jars into a one folder and saying that that folder or whatever the directory is going to become my resource path of the HTTP server. And once the HTTP server comes, we just actually say start. All level to follow till here. What we've done is that the registered callback of the Mesos, what it does is whenever your driver comes up or your scheduler comes up, it comes and registers that information, and it also starts the jar server so that it only runs one time, not like every for every submission of the job. Okay, all able to follow till here? Alright, let's go back to the slides. Okay, next. Now the question is, what we do with executors? Now if you think about the executor, what's an executor? It's a JVM. Right, it's a JVM which spawns to do some processing. Now the question is, here what we are saying is that after the JVM comes along, I want to download the jars and add it to the class path. Now it may be seem a little bit strange. What I normally think, download the jars and then start a JVM which has all those class paths. Right? But we are not doing that. So the trick is, how many of you done dynamic class loading in Java some part of? Okay, maybe only heard about it. So what we do is that in Java, there is a way to load the jars even after the JVM is started. So the way we do it, something called as URL class loader. Maybe you have heard about this, class loaders at least, which means I don't have to create a JVM with all the dependencies because I can't do it. Then I have to depend upon the Yarn or Mesos to do that. Here what I'm saying, I go to the Mesos and say, give me a JVM with only framework. Once that JVM comes up, then I'm going to the master and say, give me those jars. I download those jars, then dynamically load them into the JVM so that I don't have to create a JVM with those jars upfront. So what is the technique I'm using? I'm using something called URL class loader, which allows me to load those jars without actually have to do it in a very upfront. Then once I have those jars, it's very simple. Then only I execute my serialized function. Are you able to follow what we are trying to do?
Is it similar to dependency injection which we have in play kind of thing?
Yes, very similar. So this URL class loader is not something unique to the Spark. It's what we even use in Java for dependency injection. For example, if you are using a class, even if you do it in Spring and other frameworks, where you want to say, I want to create an instance of that class, then only you can load that jar into the your memory, then you can start using. So there is very, very similar idea. Now let me go to this code, and if you see here, again I plug this in the register. The reason is that I want to do one time, right? Because let us say I am talking about Spark streaming. This executor keeps on running forever. I don't want to keep on doing it for every job submission. What I want to do it only when the first time the executor created, so that I download all the jars and add it to the JVM. Are you able to follow till here? Okay. Now if you come here, if you just come down. Okay, register, if you see, okay. I say in the register, get class loader, and if you come down here, we say if args.length is greater than 0, because here I'm passing that URI of the jar, then what I'm saying, give me all the jars. If the args is more than 0, then what I'm doing, I am downloading the file. Here downloading the file means I'm downloading the jars, and using the URL class loaders, I'm actually adding all those jars into my JVM class path. All are able to follow? Because when you look at the design, it looks straightforward. Put HTTP server and start distributing. Not really, because there are some pieces you have to understand how to do a dynamic class loading, etc., etc. Here, what we have done, we went to the driver or the scheduler and told, give me all the jars, we download the files. How we download the files? Standard HTTP file streams. Then, once we have the files, using a URL class loader, we add those jars into the class path. Now, the reason I want to focus on URL class loader, one advantage here is that I can decide the actually which order it adds. Why it is important? In Spark, you know, there's an option called first is the user library, then is the framework library. You can say that so that all the libraries you want to give, they will be given in the first, in the class path. Everything else will be added later, because you know in Java, when it looks at the class path, whatever the class it finds first, it picks up that. It's not going to scan anymore. So that kind of thing also you can control using the URL class door. So what we have done here is that we went to the scheduler and say, give me all those files, then I want to execute. Are you able to follow? So we created a HTTP server, we created a scheduler which runs that HTTP server, we have an executor which actually downloads those files and create a URL class loader which loads into the JVM so that you can run. Okay, the final piece is where we use this. One of the examples I have used for this is, let us say I want to connect to MySQL. Because I told you, initially, my focus is not on the data analysis. But here what I want to do, I want to write a function which just say, go to the local MySQL or maybe remote MySQL here and connect and get the data back. How you do it in any language in Java, sorry, any way? JDBC. You open a JDBC connection and get the data out. But problem with the JDBC, you want to have a driver class. Right? So what I'm trying to show you is, we are going to ship the driver class as part of the our distributed jar piece, so that those drivers are available to the machine, so that I load and I can connect to the MySQL. The reason why we want to do it, we don't want to create an Uber jar, because today I'm connecting to MySQL. Tomorrow maybe I will connect to Oracle. Then what you have to do, you just have to change the jar which you ship. It's not part of your application jar itself. All are able to follow what we are doing? So we are creating a task called MySQL task, which is a function which has access to the MySQL class. Let me show you that code. Okay, if you see this MySQL task, it's a functional task. And if you see the body, do you see this load class equal to this one? So here what happening is that I am not depending upon the jar in the compile time. This is important, because if you are depending upon the compile time, you have to be there in the class path. Here what I am saying is that I am loading the class dynamically, because this is how we do it in any normal programming, where I think it is there in the class path, but I don't check for it. And then I just say successfully loaded. What I'm doing, the try catch is that if you don't give it correct jar, then you get an error saying that it is not correct, you are not able to run this task. But if you are giving the correct thing, then you get everything. If you see this, this is still a function. My abstraction is remained same. I want to run a function, but I improved my framework, which can not only give my framework jars, it can also give you the third party jars. Which means without changing the abstraction, I will keep on improving the framework, which is similar way the Spark does. In the abstraction layer in Spark, you only have like 2-3 abstractions. But underneath, you keep on improving your framework so that you can do more and more with those abstractions. Are you able to follow what is the overall idea? And this kind of idea comes from two places. One, where you want to say how to do it in Spark. And once you understand how to do it in Spark, how you can do it yourself. When you say how to do it yourself, you learn more, because you are touching the each piece of the implementation. Are you able to follow till here? So if you go to the slide, okay, there is a way to run it. I have documented in the README. Because of the time, I'm not going to do it. So I have all the links. And if you see the links, you may say, all the links are from my blog. Right, you think, where are other links? The only other links are in the source code of Spark. Right, so the reason why we are putting up these videos or blogs is so that if people want to write this kind of distributed system, which is not Spark, which is not Hadoop, they can use these ideas in order to implement a piece of it. So normally people who write, they are not going to compete with Spark or Hadoop. They want to create a small distributed system very specific to their own use case. One of the use case what we are talking was the use case which we told earlier, porting Python libraries into other things. There may be use case, for example, how you distribute your configuration files across the machines. That's your distributed system. For example, if you have heard of Marathon, they do exactly same using Mesos. Let us say you want to do similar one in Yarn. You can do with these ideas. So the idea is that it shows you kind of underneath systems where you can say, I can take a piece of functionality and I want to distribute across my machines. All are able to follow till here? Okay, So that completes our session of building distributed system part 2. I think this is like a fastest session I ever did, so which is good. Before I stop, any questions? Okay, so people are saying, that's great, everything's understood, but we don't have to ask anything here. Okay, so we stop here.